So, as you can see, the title of my presentation is not very, simple. It's, the talk is about maximum economic yield, so the title will be maximum economic yield. This talk, I can do it just presenting a typical surplus production function and to give this kind of lines in where you calculate the MSY and things like that. All right, I'm gonna use it, so you will see this kind of figure again. But before doing this, I would like to start by giving some definitions. And the first definition that I want to give is what's rent. And rent designates the difference between the raw cost of everything needed to produce the goods or services and the revenue. An important thing here is that it's due to some exclusivity. In fisheries economics, rents are excess returns above normal levels. So we have to define which are these normal levels that take place in competitive markets. Resource rent, which is a typical concept that we use in fisheries economics, is the rent obtained by the resource owner. And the proxy that we use as economists for resource rent is under some kind of discussion nowadays. For example, there are many arguments in favor of using gross value added as a proxy of rent. What is value added? Value added is just a summation of the capital remuneration and the labor remuneration. So what is these arguments in favor of using value added as a proxy? First one is that labor has rent because it is paid on a share basis. And the second one is that the skipper ownership are relatively a small scale of the fishing companies and there's a relatively small scale of the fishing companies blur the distinction between labor and capital remuneration. Nevertheless, the common approach in order to proxy what we call rent is to use profits. And in that sense, zero rent implies positive profits, unless you consider that the opportunity costs of capital and labor are zero. So this is the difference between rent and profits. Okay, let's try to explain what is MEY. It's a concept that mostly everybody knows. Here's the typical curve. We have an x-axis the effort, and in the y-axis the sustainable revenue. This is the curve. We can calculate the effort related to the MSY. We can define some fixed costs and also some variable costs. And in this variable cost, we also include the opportunity cost of the labor and the capital. So the first point that I want to mention is the point in which where rent is dissipated. And the important thing in this point is that, the rent is zero, but the profits can be positive, depending on the opportunity cost. So it's an important thing. Obviously, in terms of MEY, in terms of economics, what we want to do is to maximize the difference between the revenue and the costs. Doing so, what we obtain is this this value, which is the E effort related to the MEY. And if we look at it from the biomass point of view, we have the first conclusion of this single species approach and in a static case, which is in a single species approach, economy moves the desired target towards conservation. So, a first conclusion. I have checked some of the literature about this MSY and MEY. Some of the recent literature about this MSY and MEY ideas. And I would like to mention this paper, which is one of Christensen in 2010. And what Christensen says is something like that. If operating at the lower MEY level would result in so much higher profit to the individual boats and to the fishing sector while maintaining catches nearly at MSY, why don't they? I'm going to give you, this is the, an example of Northern Hake. It's obviously a quite a schematic example. The dots, the blue dots, are the real values in this graph of this of the Basque trawlers. So it's, I also have calculated the economic rent dissipation point and the optimum and the MSY levels. As you can see, it is true that the effort is well above the MSY and maximum economic yield point. So if we look also on, from the biomass point of view, what we see is that the biomass is also well below of the MSY and the maximum economic yield situation. So we have this question, and we have also an answer from this paper. And the current answer that Christensen gives is that the fishery sectors MEY is optimized close to but below the MSY. The higher the proportion of the total product value that is due to processing, distribution and marketing, the closer MEY will be to MSY. So the idea of this Christensen's paper is something like that. Is that at the end, if you include all this cost and all these values obtained from this processing, distribution and marketing, the MEY will be closer to the MSY, like you see, like you can see in this chart. All right, this is the thesis or the hypothesis of Christensen, and I would like to summarize in this sentence, which is that if you want to maximize the total net benefit from the complete fish chain, you should aim to land the maximum sustainable yield from the fishery. So it, now we have another question, which if it is like that, MEY is not necessary. And I would also like to mention another paper, but from Mail and Hannesson, 2010, where they analyze Christensen's thesis, which is MEY equal to MSY, and they say that this is problematic in at least two ways. The first one is that to optimize the net benefits from a sector to society, one has to take into account that if fish needs an additional handling and processing, this means additional costs. So what is often referred to as value added along the way from the fish wharf to the dinner table is in fact a cost and serves to reduce the optimal fishing effort and fish yield. The second critique is that the fisheries sector as a primary industry has the lowest, in the, for the values that they have used, output multiplier in a given economy. In cases such as this, adding units of labor and capital to the fisheries sector beyond levels appropriate to achieve MEY will result in a loss of economic welfare to the society as a whole. So two critics. And again, okay, but if operating at the lower level, why they are really so close to the MSY? Obviously the answers that this paper does is what Harding said in 68 in terms of the tragedy of the commons. And the thing is that at the end, well, given that you can enter to the fishery, or you can not enter to the fishery, but apply more effort to the fishery, at the end, what you are going to do and obtain profits from them, not necessarily rent, but profits from them, but at the end, what you are going to is move towards the right side of the effort related to the MSY. And also, we have to talk about subsidies, which is an economic important thing. Is that, all right, if we consider subsidies, instead of this cost curve, we're going to do something like that. And at the end, what we're going to do is to put the MEY close to the right of them. We are going to increase the optimum effort. So These are the critics to this paper, and in fact, the main conclusion of this Hanson and Sumaila paper is that to optimize a sector that consists of many segments through time, one has to optimize every portion of the chain through time. So this is the idea, the conclusion that we can obtain from this debate if MSY equal to MY, if we consider all the food chain or all the chain, economic chain. So MY, from this paper, MY as a concept remains useful, at least if the objective to optimize the profits and resources from the fisheries sectors maintains. But what about if the goal is to maximize employment from fishing or some other kind of social objective? And what about if we want to ensure long-term conservation of marine ecosystems and the fishery resource they support? I'm not going to talk about the social part because after me, it's going to be a talk about these social objectives, but I'm going to talk about a little bit about marine ecosystems. But first, I would like to introduce another concept, and this concept is the dynamic world. As we live in a dynamic world, and dynamics implies to assume known, not necessarily perfect, but known, evolution of inputs. And when I'm talking about input, I'm talking about fish, which are inputs, labor, effort made capital, and obviously ecological capital. From the economic side, we also need some kind of, I call it auxiliary, but it's not really auxiliary, concept like, for example, price and capital dynamics. So we need this kind of ideas. In this dynamic world, we talk a little bit yesterday about that, but the discount rate is fundamental. Obviously, because the discount rate is giving us the idea of how we are discounting the future. But from the economic point of view, there's also another important concept that I would like to introduce. Like many other science, we economists will have also a golden rule. And in this golden rule, which is the capital accumulation golden rule, the discount rate is critical. In fact, what we say in this golden rule is that the marginal gain from increasing the harvest has to equal the present value of the losses derived from this increase. If we look at what does this sentence mean, I can say that, all right, if we want to, it can be optimal to increase the total harvest depending on the discount rate that we are selecting. Obviously, I'm not going to enter in the debate of which discount rate is the right one. But there's a big debate about that. We have to consider present versus future necessities. Obviously, they are not the same for the same for the different users, for the different resources. And in fact, nowadays we don't have clear what is a free risk in the current situation. So it's a big debate about that, but I'm not going to answer about that. But I would like just to mention that discount rate is critical from the economic point of view. And in fact, I can also make this citation of Hilborn, Grafton and Compass in 2007, where in practical, for normal discount rates, conservation promotes both larger fish and larger fish stocks and higher profits. So just like this. Okay, if we're looking at the relationship between the MEY and the ecosystem, we can end up with some problems. The first one is the property rate problems, where we have problems with the aspects of fugitive and straddling stocks. We have not similar legal systems, different levels of development. We have industrial and artisanal fleets, and values related to migration issues. Also, we have to consider that there are implications for fishing rents and for the meaning of rent depletion. That is, the thing, the idea is that if we can harvest at the top and at the bottom of the food chain simultaneously, does it make more sense to leave low-value fish in the sea and let higher-value commercial fish eat them? In terms, we also have problems with the bycatch and other principal agent issues. In fact, what we could simply summarize this problem as that the wall is based on some incentives, and these incentives standards are perverse. We also have to take into consideration implication for eco-labeling and other value-adding processes. We also have to consider the problem with the ITQs or IQs, where some fish can be considered only as inputs to the system, not as an output. But in general, the idea of the relationship between MEY and ecosystem is that we have to internalize all the costs that we are imposing to the system. And in that sense, if we internalize the cost of using ecosystem services, we end up with a situation like that, where at the end, what we're moving is to a lower effort optimum situation. Okay, just to finalize, I'm going to introduce the problem with the constraints and the economy. Okay, we have a multi-species system. We have ecosystem contest in which fisheries have to manage. So at the end, what we have is that constraints strengthen the area of possible solutions. In economy, or more than economy, in mathematics, we have what we call it shadow values. And these shadow values, what they do is to provide the utility of relaxing constraints or the cost of strengthening them. Obviously in marginal terms. In other words, even if we have a non-economic objective, it can have an economic interpretation in terms of the utility that we are optimizing. Finally, I would like just to finalize my talk that we have many regulations in terms of the MSFD, the CFP, the Common Fisheries Policy itself, the good environmental status. At the end, we have too many constraints that could reduce the target debate to how to compute it and how to reach to a predefined, by the constraints, desired target area. And it's an area because we have to consider also the uncertainty. So at the end, what we have is a state space, a target region, which is defining our system. We have the current situation, and at the end, what we want to do is that we want to finalize saying that the optimal policy is the harvest control rule that maximizes the transitional path to the stationary solution. So that's my talk. Thank you.